On the anniversary of the January 12, 2010 magnitude 7.0 earthquake in Haiti, it's important to reflect on the plate tectonic context and human impact of that event. The Caribbean plate moves eastward at about 2 centimeters per year with respect to the North American and South American plates. The boundary between the North American and Caribbean plates in the Greater Antilles is a zone of distributed deformation broken into at least 4 microplates. These microplates accommodate the transition of the North American Caribbean plate boundary from strike slip in the Cayman Trough between Cuba and Jamaica to oblique collision between Hispaniola and the Bahama platform, to oblique subduction at the Puerto Rico Trench, and then to subduction at the Lesser Antilles Trench. The largest of these is the Gonave microplate that stretches from the Cayman Spreading Center to western Hispaniola. In Haiti, the Gonave microplate is bounded on the north by the Septentrional Fault and on the south by the Enriquillo Fault. These faults are predominantly left lateral strike slip faults and both have rates of long-term motion of about 1 centimeter per year. Major earthquakes on the Enriquillo Fault were documented in 1751 and 1770. They were followed in 1842 and 1887 by major earthquakes on the Septentrional Fault. Over the following centuries, the region around Port-au-Prince grew to over 300 million people. Then, with little warning, the magnitude 7.0 earthquake occurred on the Ligon Fault, just north of the Enriquillo Fault. The epicenter was only 16 kilometers from Port-au-Prince. Rupture initiated at 12 kilometers depth and progressed upward and to the west, reaching maximum fault displacement of 5 meters at 5 kilometers depth. Resulting ground shaking in Port-au-Prince was strong to severe, with liquefaction occurring in port areas and landslides affecting slopes. At least 52 felt aftershocks greater than magnitude 4.5 were recorded in the next 12 days. The human impact of the 2010 Haiti earthquake was horrendous, with estimates of at least 100,000 and possibly over 200,000 fatalities. Over 1 million people were left homeless. This earthquake was the 4th most lethal earthquake of any magnitude in the last 100 years and was 5 times more fatal than any historical magnitude 7 earthquake. Why was this earthquake so deadly? In a word, construction. Typical concrete and cinder block buildings can survive hurricane force winds, but are extremely vulnerable to earthquake ground shaking. Many structures collapsed because the lightly reinforced or unreinforced concrete columns or masonry block walls could not support the heavy concrete slabs of floors and roofs. The ability of modern buildings, like this one across the street from the hospital, to withstand ground shaking virtually undamaged demonstrates the effectiveness of earthquake-resistant design and construction. In addition to overcrowding, Haiti is the most impoverished nation in the Western Hemisphere. This, and the remoteness of the island, made cleanup a monumental task. Plus, rebuilding using the best, thus most expensive, construction materials and methods was just not economically feasible. Nevertheless, important measures were taken to increase earthquake resilience during the recovery and rebuilding. Major efforts by the Haitian government and non-governmental agencies, such as Geohazards International and Build Change, included training local people to incorporate cost-effective, earthquake-resistant design into the rebuilding and new construction. The devastating losses in Haiti are a lesson to other seismically active areas around the world. How buildings are constructed matters, and engineering buildings and infrastructure to survive earthquake shaking can save lives and property, as well as help communities to recover more quickly after disaster strikes. Thank you.